like to welcome our guests from Baystate Franklin Medical's Radiology Department. They are going to tell us all about the educational requirements, the challenges, what the job is like, and the different experiences they've had in this career today. And I'd like to first start by introducing Sheri Thayer. She's the clinical instructor for Baystate Franklin Medical's Radiologic Technology program, and she will tell you a lot more about this field, and I hope it will be something that you will find interesting, and you'll have some questions towards the end of the evening. Sheri.
Thank you. Good evening. As Sarah said, my name is Sheri Thayer. I am the clinical instructor at Baystate Franklin Medical Center's radiology department. I have been a registered radiologic technologist for a little over 18 years now, and I've been at Franklin the entire time. So what I've brought today is a PowerPoint presentation to share with you that will pretty much outline our profession, some of the highlights, some of the things, if you think you're interested in it, may make you look at it and say, yes, I'm definitely interested, or no, I'm definitely not interested. Some of the prerequisites that you should be looking at today, and a little bit of the admissions process and the profession as a whole. So if you take a look over here, if this is Slim, this is our mascot. Monica was actually one of my students before she became a technologist, and Slim lives in my office, so you can go ahead and switch to the next screen. I couldn't leave him out. As I said, I am an RTR, or a registered radiologic technologist. Radiologic science is a dynamic field which combines patient care and technology skills. I think a lot of times people get really excited about the technology of our field, but it's really important to remember that without the patients, we wouldn't have a field at all. So you have to feel comfortable working with people, actually having hands-on, touching people, and not all of our patients are walkie-talkie, come in and do what they need to do patients. We have patients in on stretchers who may need physical and emotional assistance from you, so that's important. Radiologic technologist is a professional key member of the healthcare team who creates images used to diagnose patient injury or illness. And we do all types of different kinds of x-rays. You need to be strong in the following areas if you think you're interested in our program. You need to be able to communicate with your patients and with your employees. You need to have strong patient care skills. You need to be able to adapt to changing employment demands. You need to recognize that growth within the profession is achieved through lifelong continuing education. So really, your education does not end when you graduate. It really begins and is part of your licensure as a professional. You will need to continue with continuing education credits throughout your entire professional career. Radiologic technologists are educated in some of the following areas: human anatomy and physiology, patient positioning, technique, radiation safety and protection, patient care, physics, math, pathology, and quality assessment. So those are some of the areas in the core program, as well as some of those are prerequisites that you'd be covering. The prerequisite courses that you need to be thinking about now prior to even applying to the program are chemistry. You can use high school chemistry if it was in the last 5 years prior to applying to the program. You will need to have one or two semesters of math, depending on which courses you've taken. Anatomy and physiology 1 and 2, that would need to have been taken within the last 5 years. And as far as your gen ed requirements, your English requirements, 2 semesters worth, and then your social sciences, as they're listed there, and those are something every community college requires you to have. So those are the things you'd need to be thinking about now. Requirements for admission: we do Cori and Sori checks. That means criminal backgrounds as well as sexual offense backgrounds. You do need to attend an information session, which is offered at HCC. And it's important that you have an idea of some of the things that you'll need to be required to perform as a technologist. You need to help position patients and move them from wheelchairs and stretchers to x-ray tables. So you do need to be physically strong. We don't sit in chairs all day long and take pictures from a chair. We are out there moving patients. You need to be able to position, place, and move equipment around. Some of it is heavy. You need to be able to respond to signals such as sound and light. All of our equipment does make noise. You need to be able to realize when your equipment isn't working properly. Definitely communication is key. You have to have good communication skills or be willing to improve your skills. You need to be comfortable palpating patients. That's a word we use, which is you're actually making physical contact with your patients to be able to find the different anatomical landmarks that we need to find different things that we can't see from the outside. You need to be able to feel comfortable filling syringes, enema bags. You need to feel comfortable changing a bedpan if necessary. It's not a huge part of our job, but it does happen. And you do need to be able to determine differences in gradual changes in blacks, grays, and whites to be able to properly analyze the images. What does the program entail? The core program is 2 years. You will end up with an associate's degree program. It's really more of a 3-year program if you do it full time, because you probably will have at least 1 year of your prerequisites prior to even applying to the program. The core program itself is a full 2-year program. Your time is divided between the classroom, learning at the college in the classroom, and in a clinical setting. We do have 5 clinical sites in various areas in Western Massachusetts. We have Brattleboro Memorial Hospital in Brattleboro, Vermont. We have Baystate Franklin Medical Center here in Greenfield. We have Cooley Dickinson Hospital in Northampton. We have Holyoke Medical Center and Mercy Medical Center. So our students, although they're all together in the classroom, they do go to various clinical sites. And one thing to keep in mind is the clinical rotation does require both day and evening commitments. And those are things that if you go online, everything is outlined, so you would know prior to applying if this is something that would fit into your life. Important to know, you must earn a grade of 73% or better in all core classroom and clinical courses. The reason we do that is because our national boards do require you to earn a 73% or better. So we feel that if you can't earn a 73% in the classroom, chances are you're not going to be able to pass your boards. So in any core courses, I'm not talking prerequisites, but in the core courses, you do need to earn a 73% or better. Clinical competency testing. This is something you'll do in the clinical setting. Each student is required to demonstrate the ability to perform clinical examinations under the direct supervision of a technologist. So basically, when you're in clinic, you're going to be x-raying real patients. And that's how we determine when you're able to move on to another exam. There is a total of 52 competencies that you must complete before the end of the program. So, next screen. There is a dress code. All of our students wear navy scrubs. Compared to what I wore 20 years ago, that's nothing. You can't have any neon hair colors, no artificial nails or nail polish, no visible tattoos, and no piercings other than pierced ears. So just something to think about if you're comfortable with all of those things. Where are we in the hospital? We're all over. We're in the x-ray department, we're in the emergency department, we're in the surgical department, we're in the patient rooms on the floor, we're in the neonatal intensive care unit where the babies are, and we're in intensive care. We're in surgery, we're in trauma situations, we're all over the place. Next screen. What kind of degree will I earn? BFMC is affiliated with Holyoke Community College. Holyoke Community College is a 2-year associate degree program. So in the end, you would earn an associate degree of science in radiologic technology. What happens then? You'll sit for and pass with a 73% or better for the ARRT, the American Registry of Radiologic Technologists. That's our national board examination. just like nurses take boards, we take boards. And then once you pass, you will need to apply for state licensure. That is not mandated in every single state. It is in Massachusetts, Connecticut, Vermont, so where applicable. Can I advance? Yes, you can. With additional on-the-job training, you can move into CAT scan, MRI, interventional procedures, mobile unit radiography, mammography, bone density, angiography, education, which is what I do, which may require you to have a higher degree, and administration as well. So there's lots of room to move. Next screen. What types of images are taken? We take images of just about anything you can think of in your body. What I've done here is just shown you, this would be of the chest. The image on the left would be a normal x-ray. The image on the right would be an abnormal x-ray. This person was in a motorcycle accident. This would be of the abdomen. Again, on the left, we have a normal abdominal film. On the right, we have somebody who likes to eat things they shouldn't eat. In this case, pencils and pens. So you're going to see anything you could possibly imagine. The spine, on the left, a normal, what we call lateral cervical spine. This is a side picture of your neck. On the right, if you see my arrow, there is a fracture of the fifth cervical vertebrae. So that's definitely something you may see. The skeleton, anything within the extremities, the spine. This shows a femur. The left image, far left image, is a normal femur. Middle image, clearly broken. And the right image is a post-operative view of how they reduced this person's femur, so how they would fix it. And we would be involved in all three of those situations. The upper GI system, on the left, we've had this patient drink a lovely barium shake to be able to see the soft tissues of the abdomen. That would be a normal image. On the right, this person does have an obstruction of the small bowel. The lower GI system, or large bowel, on the left, we've done a barium enema to visualize a normal large bowel. And on the right, the arrows are pointing to what we call an apple core tumor. So we see cancers and all kinds of things. The urinary system, the one on the far left, is a normal view of something we call an intravenous pyelogram, where we've injected dye into this person's system to be able to view the kidneys, ureters, and bladder. The one in the middle does show a kidney stone, which is obstructing flow from the kidney to the bladder. And then the far right image is showing a double collecting system, which is something you may have and you wouldn't even know it unless you came for an x-ray. The kidney on what looks like the right, but it's actually the left because we flip the images when we look at them, has two collecting systems, so two tubes leading to the ureter. We do spinal cord imaging. This is something called a myelogram. And the arrows are all pointing to stenosis of the L3, L4 area, so that dye is not flowing. There's a narrowing of the spinal column in that area. And it's followed up by an MRI image on the right. This is just a quick overview of some of the equipment we have in our department. This would be a regular x-ray machine. And it's also capable of doing fluoroscopy procedures, as we saw in some of the images that we just looked at. This is what we would bring up to surgery. It's a mobile fluoroscopy unit. This is a portable x-ray unit that we would bring to the emergency room or to patient floors when patients are too sick to come to us. So what do we use to generate images? We use computerized radiography cassettes and readers. These are some of the cassettes that we use. These are how we read our images. It's all electronic now. We don't use dark rooms. Everything is done in the computer. This is the multi-reader, which takes more than one cassette at a time. So how do we view our images? If we're not actually developing films and actually reading x-rays, how do we do it? We use a picture archival and communication system. Each image is reviewed on the computer, and we now use the PAC system to view, edit, diagnose, and store images electronically. So when you come to the x-ray department, we don't have a folder full of x-ray images that we pull out with your name on it. It's all on the computer. As a technologist, some of the things you need to remember, as I've said repeatedly, communication is very important. Confidentiality is extremely important. Professionalism, respect, and personal understanding. Patient care, treat each of your patients like they're one of your own family members, your mother, your father, your brother, your sister, or your child. And these are my monkeys. So I like to say, like the commercial, what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. What happens in the hospital stays in the hospital. Confidential information can be verbal or written. You're never to discuss any private information in hallways, elevators, the cafeteria, or any other public area in the hospital. And respect the right to privacy for each one of your patients. Part of the process of learning, other than x-raying your patients, we have phantoms that we use because unfortunately we can't go around just x-raying each other, which sounds like a lot of fun but is not healthy. We have different body parts that are actual human bones encased in a tissue equivalent material that allows us to x-ray them just like we would a regular body part. And we use these a lot for testing and experimenting. So that's a big part of your clinical experience. Next screen. So in conclusion, if you need any additional information, you can always go to the HCC website. And of course, I'm here representing just one of many programs out there for radiology, but that's who I'm affiliated with. So you can go to hcc.edu or feel free to contact me at the hospital. And my email address is right there. So thank you.
Thank you, Sheri.
Thank you.
I just had one other question I wanted to pose to you because mm-hmm. I think it's so interesting to find out why people select a career path. And I just wanted to ask how you chose this as your career from the beginning when you first started looking at what you were going to do with the rest mm-hmm. of your life. Mm-hmm.
I actually started off as a psychology major at UMass, had a really miserable year, and this was something I had considered prior to starting at UMass, and I said, you know what, let's give it a try, and I've never looked back. My associate's degree was very good to me for 15 years, and 2 years ago I did finish my bachelor's degree at UMass, so it took me 15 years to do that. But I can't imagine doing anything other than healthcare. I wouldn't even know where to begin to do anything else.
And then my final question for you is just, what do you think are the challenges that you face today working in this field?
I think one of the biggest challenges is keeping up with the technology, especially being in a teaching position. At some points now, I feel like I'm learning things at the same time the students are, or maybe I'm one step ahead. The technology is just flying upon us, which is really exciting, and yet at the same time can be kind of scary when you were used to doing x-rays one way for such a long time, and now it's changing really fast.
That's great. Well, thank you very much for sharing your story. And our next speaker is Monica Dane, and she's a recent graduate of the program, so she would have that perspective of someone who's new to the field. And she is a radiologic technologist at Baystate Franklin Medical as well, and a student of Sheri's, former student. Mm-hmm. So if you'd like to share some of your experiences with us, Monica, as a new graduate. How did you choose the career?
Well, I chose the career because I knew that I like sciences and technology.
Right.
And I didn't want to do nursing. I knew that it wasn't for me. And I had a couple of options, but I just kind of picked this. And like Sheri said, I never looked back. I got into the program, and I just loved it. And I love what I do.
That's great. And what is your educational background? You said you had started at Greenfield Community College?
Yep. I graduated from Greenfield High School in 2002.
Okay.
And right after that, I started going to GCC. And I graduated from GCC in 2006 with my associate's degree in liberal arts. Mm-hmm. And then I went to HCC, to the Radiologic Technology Program. And I graduated from there in 2008 with my associate's of science in radiologic technology.
Great. And were you able to take your credentialing testing and everything right after graduation?
Yep, right after graduation. June 5th, and I graduated May 31st.
Yeah. Okay. And do you have any kind of any story to share with us about what you love about your work or a meaningful experience that you had as a person who's who's working in the field and something that stands out in your mind?
I don't know about any stories, but I just like working with the public. I like working with people. I like the feeling of helping people. And I'm really lucky that I get to work with a lot of great people in the department, and I have a lot of fun at work every day.
Good crew.
Yeah, I like going to work every day. It's fun.
Yeah, it sounds like it's a real teamwork type
it is,
of
very much.
Profession. And do you? What are some of the challenges that you've been exposed to in this field as you've been working here in Greenfield?
Mm-hmm. As a technologist, the challenges that I still face are usually down in the emergency room. People come in, they're really hurt. They can't move certain body parts, whatever, you know, is ailing them. And we just have to work around that and improvise to find other ways to get the good pictures that the doctors need to, you know, read them and diagnose the patient. So that's usually a pretty big challenge.
Okay. And what is a typical day like for you?
Oh, yes, I wrote this all down. Typical day is waking up very early. I'm not going to lie, it is. I usually get up between 5:30 and 7:30 a.m. 7:30 is the latest time I usually get up every morning. These times depend on where I'm scheduled for the day. At Baystate Franklin Medical Center, the emergency room, the operating room, and the main department all have different times that you're scheduled to come in at. So it all depends on where you are. And in the morning, we work with HCC senior students who have been in the program for a year and a half by now. So they're pretty self-sufficient. They can take x-rays by themselves, and we usually just have to check the x-rays for them. And then lunch is usually around 11:30 or noon. We get a half-hour lunch. And then in the afternoon, we work with the Holyoke Community College freshmen who are a little bit, they need a little bit more explanation and a little bit more guidance. But it's a good experience because you have to almost reteach yourself because you're teaching somebody else. So you have to pull everything back and explain things to them. And then my day usually ends between 3:30 to 5:30, depending on what time I came into work that day.
Okay. Well, thank you. Is there anything else that either one of you would like to add that you didn't get to touch upon earlier? You feel like you've said it all.
I think the one thing you said, it is a team effort. Monica mm-hmm. and I do work in the same department. We work really closely with each other, and we have a lot of fun, too, mm-hmm. so in the process. And another thing, as Monica was mentioning, working in the emergency room with people who are hurt, there is a lot of critical thinking that goes on. In the program, we do teach you the basics of positioning. But one thing you do need to be able to do is take that, what we like to call the walkie-talkie patient, who can do everything that you need them to do, and be able to do some real common sense thinking on how am I going to do this on somebody who's laying flat on their back and can't help me at all. So it's really important to be able to think outside of the box and be able to change your way of thinking based on your patient's needs.
Yeah, not everything's textbook. You learn right. in the positioning class from the book, but once you get to the hospital and you start doing your clinicals, everything changes.
Right.
Everything's different. So you have to, go out of your, look outside the box.
Yep.
Well, thank you both very much for coming. I wanted to just open this up to any questions from the group. If there's something that has struck you from the presentation or any questions that we haven't touched upon today, feel free to let us know what you'd like to hear about from our two speakers.
We must have covered it all.
We must have been a very thorough presentation. Well, thank you again. You've given us a lot to talk about and discuss about in
good,
our class,
good.
And hopefully we'll have some new converts to the career of radiologic technology. So thank you.